Penguin Random House Audio presents The Hypnotist, a Joona Linna novel by Lars Kepler, translated from the Swedish by Neil Smith, read for you by Saul Reichlin.
Like fire, just like fire.
Those were the first words the hypnotized teenage boy spoke. Even though he had life-threatening injuries, hundreds of cuts to his face, legs, torso, back, the soles of his feet, and on his neck and the back of his head, he had been put into a state of deep hypnosis in the hope that he would be able to describe what he had seen.
"I'm trying to blink," he muttered. "I'm going into the kitchen, but it's not right. There's lots of crackling between the chairs and bright red fire spreading across the floor."
The policeman who found him among the other bodies in the row house thought he was dead. The boy had lost a lot of blood. He had gone into a state of shock and had not regained consciousness for 7 hours. He was the only surviving witness, and Detective Joona Linna thought it likely that he could give them a good description. Whoever attacked the family had intended to kill them all, so he probably hadn't bothered to hide his face. But if the circumstances weren't quite so extraordinary, no one would ever have considered calling in a hypnotist. In Greek mythology, the god Hypnos is a boy with wings carrying poppy seed pods in his hand. His name means sleep. He is the twin brother of death and the son of night and darkness. The term hypnosis was first coined in 1843 by the Scottish surgeon James Braid. He used it to describe a sleep-like state of both heightened awareness and extreme receptivity. Today it has been proved scientifically that almost anyone is susceptible to hypnosis, but opinion still varies on its uses, reliability, and safety. The lack of consensus probably stems from the fact that hypnosis has been misused by cheats, entertainers, and secret services the world over. In purely technical terms, it is easy to put someone into a hypnotic state. The hard part is controlling the process, guiding the patient, and analyzing the results. It takes great skill to manage deep hypnosis. There are only a handful of medically qualified, genuine expert hypnotists in the entire world. Chapter 1. Early Tuesday morning, December the 8th. Eric's phone is ringing. Before he is fully awake, he says, "Balloons and streamers." His heart is racing from being awakened so suddenly. Eric doesn't know why he said that. He has no idea what he had been dreaming about. In order not to wake Simon, he creeps out of the bedroom and closes the door before he answers. "Hello, this is Erik Maria Bark." A detective by the name of Joona Linna tells him that he needs his help. Eric is only half awake as he listens. "I've heard you're good at dealing with trauma," the detective says. "Yes," Eric replies simply. He takes a Tylenol as he listens. The detective explains that he needs to question someone, a 15-year-old boy who has witnessed a double murder. The problem is that the teenager has been seriously injured and is in an unstable condition. He's in a state of shock and he hasn't yet regained consciousness. "Who's treating him?" Eric asks. "Daniela Richards. She's highly competent. I'm sure she'll be able to..." "It was her idea to call you," the detective interrupts. "We need your help and we probably don't have much time." Eric goes back into the bedroom to get his clothes. A streetlight shines in between the blinds. Simon is lying on her back, watching him with an oddly vacant expression.
"I was trying not to wake you," he says softly. "Who is that?" she asks.
"A police officer, a detective. I didn't catch his name."
What did he want?
I have to go to Karolinska, he replies. They need help with a teenage boy.
What time is it anyway?
She looks at the alarm clock and closes her eyes. He can see the lines made by folds in the sheet across her freckled shoulders.
Go back to sleep, Simon, he whispers.
Erik carries his clothes out into the hallway, turns the light on, and quickly gets dressed. A length of steel suddenly flashes behind him. Erik turns and sees that his son has hung his ice skates from the handle of the front door so that he won't forget them. Even though Erik is in a hurry, he goes over to the closet and digs out the protective guards. He fastens them to the sharp blades, then puts them down on the hall carpet and leaves. It's 3 o'clock in the morning, on Tuesday, December the 8th. Snow is falling slowly from the black sky. There's no wind at all, and the heavy flakes land sleepily on the deserted street. He turns the key in the ignition, and a soft wave of music rolls through the car. Miles Davis, Kind of Blue. He drives the short distance through the sleeping city, down Lundmakar Street and along Svea Boulevard towards Nortul. The water of Brunn's Lake is a large, dark expanse beyond the snow. He drives slowly into the hospital campus between the understaffed Astrid Lindgren's Children's Hospital and the maternity ward, past the radiotherapy department and psychiatric unit, and parks in his usual spot in front of neurosurgery. The glow of the streetlights reflects off the windows of the large complex. There are hardly any cars in the parking lot. Blackbirds flit through the gloom around the trees. The flapping of their wings breaks the silence. He swipes his card, taps in the 6-digit code, and enters the lobby, then takes the elevator up to the 5th floor and walks down the hall. The fluorescent lights reflect off the blue linoleum floor, making it look like ice. Now that the initial adrenaline rush is fading, he starts to feel tired. He passes an operating room and walks past the doors to the huge hyperbaric chamber, then says hello to a nurse as he recalls what the detective told him over the phone. A teenage boy has knife wounds all over his body. The police attempted to speak to him, but his condition deteriorated quickly. 2 uniformed police officers are standing outside the door to Ward 18. Erik can see a trace of anxiety cross their faces as he approaches. Maybe they're just tired, he thinks, as he stops in front of them and shows them his ID. They glance at it, and then one of them presses the button to make the door swing open. Erik walks in and shakes hands with Daniela Richards, noting the tension in her face and the stress in the way she moves.
Grab some coffee, she says.
Do we have time? Erik asks.
I've managed to get the bleeding from his liver under control, she replies.
A man in his mid-40s, dressed in jeans and a black jacket, is tapping the frame of the coffee machine. His blonde hair is messy and his lips are clenched. Erik wonders if he might be Daniela's husband, Magnus. He's never met him, just seen a picture in her office.
Is that Magnus? Erik asks, gesturing toward the man. What?
She looks both amused and surprised. I thought maybe Magnus had come with you.
No, she says, laughing.
Are you sure? Maybe I should ask him, Erik jokes, and starts to walk toward the man. Daniela's cell phone rings, and she's still laughing as she takes it out.
Stop it, Erik, she says, as she answers and puts the phone to her ear. Yes, Daniela here. She listens but can't hear anything. Hello?
She waits a few seconds, then ends the call with a sarcastic, "Have a nice day," slips the phone in her pocket and follows Erik. He's already walked over to the blonde man. The coffee machine is bubbling and wheezing.
Have some coffee?
The man says, trying to hand Erik a mug.
No thanks.
The man tastes the coffee and smiles, revealing dimples in his cheeks. It's good, he says, and tries to give Eric the mug again. I don't want any. The man drinks some more as he looks at Eric. Could I borrow your phone? He suddenly asks. I left mine in my car. You want
to borrow? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.